Welcome to fourth episode of APC RSHR 10 Dialogues. As you know, these online interviews every fortnight on sexual and reproductive health and rights related issues in Asia Pacific in context of 2020 realities and SDG goals are happening this year. And it's more important now because despite the challenge which has been posed by the coronavirus disease or COVID-19, we are determined to continue the online and virtual learning, knowledge sharing, information exchange, and around issues of sexual and reproductive health and rights in the context of Asia Pacific. And these APCR SHR 10 dialogue is an example of this. Today, we have a very special guest amongst us. Dr. Ishwar Gilada was elected to the Governing Council of International AIDS Society from Asia and the Pacific. He is also the president of AIDS Society of India. He was among the first doctors who began HIV care when first AIDS got diagnosed in the country. So, Dr. Gilada, most welcome. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us in this session. This is being co-hosted by CNS and APC RSHR 10. Dr. Gilada, all the countries in Asia Pacific have committed to end AIDS by 2030. We have around 130 months left for that. And all the countries in the Asia and the Pacific have committed to deliver on 90-90-90 targets HIV related. And we have less than 9.5 months for that. So, sir, where are we in context of of the HIV and SRHHR targets in the region?
Thank you, Bobby. First, let us understand what are these targets of 90-90-90 and how does it quantify in numbers. Basically, 90-90-90 is those people who are infected with HIV, 90% of them should know their HIV status. Those who know their HIV status, 90% of them should be on ART. And those who are on ART, that is antiretroviral therapy, 90% of them should have suppressed viral load. Now, this is the ideal scenario where 90-90-90 means it is not 10% shortfall. If you consider that we have achieved 90-90-90 by this 2020, we already started, we already finished almost 2.5 months. It means 90% of 90% is 81% and 90% of 81 is 72%. So the achievement, when you have 90-90-90 achieved, that means we have achieved only 72%. Which is not even distinction. And most countries have not achieved 90-90-90 by this year. India is currently somewhere around maybe 75% of the people who know their status, maybe 80% of those who know their status, they are on ART. And fortunately, most of them are suppressed, maybe about 80 or 85% of them are suppressed. So if you calculate that, it goes to somewhere around 50 to 55% achievement. Still, we need another 12-13% or minimum 12% achievement, even if we consider we are 60% to achieve that goal. And we have still 9 months to go. Possibly India will achieve this target. The smaller countries in Africa, a lot of countries like Malawi, Botswana, they have achieved the target long back, a year before also. In our region, Cambodia, Thailand, Vietnam, they're doing much better. Hong Kong, Singapore, they're doing much better. But there are countries which are much behind. They are behind because of two, three issues. Asia Pacific region has a lot of cultural boundaries and a lot of cultural taboos where people do not talk openly about HIV/AIDS, do not talk anything about sexuality, about STDs. And under this situation, even if we know that husband is infected, we tell that husband to bring wife, wife doesn't come, wife is not being told, husband doesn't bring the wife. So there will be several reasons. Similarly, some people who have a fatalistic approach and they think that anyway, we are going to die, but why worry about HIV? Some people have a lot of notions about treatment, though nowadays a lot of safer treatment are there. However, in some countries like, say, Indonesia, they are still not on even efavirenz-based regimen. They are, most of them, on nevirapine-based regimen. So to transition them from nevirapine to efavirenz to dolutegravir, it will take little time. I recently returned from Jakarta after consultation with lot of doctors and healthcare workers from Jakarta, which was organized through Indonesia AIDS Coalition. There, they would like to come on Bulldogger's base regimen, but still there are hitches, and at present, they would reach up only TLE 400. Tenofovir, lamivudine, and ifavir is 400. Similarly, there could be there are regions, there are countries like in Bangladesh or Pakistan. They are way behind. So this target of 1990 possibly will be achieved by 50 to 60% of the countries in our region. And another 50, 60 countries will may take another year or two, if at all they are determined. Now, the next target, I think it is a long way to go. There are 10 years in our hand. It all depend on our determination for first target of 1990. Then only we can talk about 100, 100, 100. So basically, let us only focus on 1990 as far as HIV is concerned.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much for these insights, sir. And it's because the time is really running out in terms of 1990. We only have about 9.5 months left to meet these targets. And it is very important also because this is like if we meet these, this is like a stepping stone to 100, 100, 100. So we really need to accelerate places. So you brought a range of issues related to gender justice, like the silence of culture, silence of on issues related to sexuality, the cultural taboos. So sir, which components of sexual and reproductive health services need more attention in the Asia Pacific region, so that not only sexual and reproductive health services, there is a better uptake of those, but also it helps HIV, like in terms of maternal mortality or in terms of children, for example, or cultural taboos also, like child marriage is a reality in our South Asian region specifically. Adolescent pregnancy is a huge challenge in Southeast Asia, for instance. So, okay, so can you please share some insights on this?
When we started HIV work, we started through STIs. That time we used to call venereal diseases or sexually transmitted diseases, then it became STI. Now it became sexual health related issues. So we started through that, and then we entered in HIV. After HIV came in, because of the HIV awareness, STDs or sexually transmitted infections have gone down so much that in most places they are almost 90% less than what they were about 10, 20 or 30 years back. Number two, currently what we see that because everybody only talk about HIV, we achieve good targets in HIV, we achieve good treatment in HIV, and most of the governments have spent very well on HIV related issues. But in the process, STIs or STDs were neglected. Now today what we see is an upsurge of STDs which were under control about 10 years or 5 years or 20 years back. They are coming back again. We see a lot of herpes coming up, we see a lot of HPV coming up, we see syphilis is still there in this era. We also see secondary syphilis and tertiary syphilis or neurosyphilis. So this is ridiculous, means we could have covered that long back, but they're coming back. In between, about 10 years back, we hardly see any gonorrhea. Now again, we started seeing in my clinic, at least I see once in a month, one or two gonorrhea patient coming, chlamydia infection patient coming. So when we talk only HIV, and particularly in the era when we talk about PrEP and PEP, pre-exposure prophylaxis and post-exposure prophylaxis, they talk on chemical prophylaxis. They talk about antiretroviral drugs to be given to prevent HIV infection. So people, when they're promoting PrEP or PEP, they forgotten to think that this is in addition to your other barrier protection, whether it's a male condom or female condom. Now, if barrier condom, barrier protection is not used and you are only using PrEP or PEP, you are controlling HIV, but you are inviting other STIs. And that's what is happening. There are some young boys who come for a lot of consultation on STIs, and some of them do travel to Bangkok or other places in our region. And when they come, they bring in some STIs. And when they come and we talk to them, they said, sir, you told me you take PrEP, we have taken PrEP, so how did I get it? I said, PrEP was only for HIV, it was not for STIs. So despite we talking to them, being a person involved from STIs to HIV, and HIV and STI together I'm considering, and always delivering those kind of issues to people, despite that, our patients are making this kind of mistake. So you can imagine that if it is going in the raw hands, people are only talking about PrEP and PEP. They are not talking that PrEP and PEP is in addition to barrier protection. We are inviting a lot of STIs. Number two, a lot of people who pick up STI, unknowingly they pass on to their partners and they say that, no, I am with only one partner. Now, that one partner is definitely only one partner for him, but this fellow has another partner. So they keep on passing that infection to other partner, and in their group, the other infections are spreading. So we need to look at this issue. This conference is very good that it is focusing on STIs. No doubt the focus is also on HIV, but they are talking about sexual and reproductive health issues, which are related to maternal child health as well as STIs.
Thank you so much, sir. This is really important because STIs often get less attention compared to HIV. And in some countries, the STI program is almost merged with the HIV program and very little attention. And you're right, the rates of STIs are alarming. And thanks for mentioning like STIs like herpes, syphilis, gonorrhea, chlamydia, they are again, it's setting an alarm. So what about HIV and STIs in key populations in the region, particularly HIV related key populations, for example, like transgender and men who have sex with men or sex workers or injecting drug use. So are the rates alarming in the key populations in the region?
It is alarming currently because there has been a little bit change in the last 1.5 years after the repeal of Section 377. Thereafter, it's not that it was not happening earlier, it was happening earlier too, but now people have opened up so much so that they are coming in large numbers. I never used to get a lot of MSM population coming to my clinic, which I had seen in last, 1.5 years, 2 years. So they are now coming up, and there is a lot of living in together, there is a lot of MSM sexuality happening. It may have been happening earlier, but we were not aware of because of so many issues. It was hidden, they were not coming up, they were scared of legal issues, they were scared of being caught by police, whatever. Now, recently one of the patients came and I just happened to ask him that I asked him how many partners, and he said it could be 200, 300, maybe up to 500 partners. So I asked, where do you get partners and where do you have sexual interaction? Because he looked from middle class. I did not comprehend that how he will be spending on his sexual activity. So he said, sir, you don't need anything for MSM. For male to female sex, you need room and other facilities or hotel. Or here we do in theater. I said, how do you do in theater? He said, there's a theater which is on the road of my clinic. And I knew that theater, but I never knew. I used to see some kind of new films or movies going on there. Always some sexual connotation movies were there. But I never knew that this is a place for sexual encounter. So these people, and he said that when movies are on, the movie is on, and here the activities are on. So everything was happening in the theater. So if this kind of thing, so much sexuality has opened up so much, then they are bound to invite trouble. Number two, after HIV awareness, people talk only vaginal sex and anal sex. And they said that these are dangerous. These are high-risk activity. You should protect this. You should use condom, barrier protection, etc. But what about oral sex? Nobody discussed oral sex earlier. Now, a lot of them are indulging in oral sex. Orogenital sex, genital-oral sex, both male and female. So in that kind of situation, there has been recently a study from Tata Cancer Hospital where in HPV cancers, they realized that about 20% of those cancers are through oral sex. And reversely also, they looked at oral cancers where about 15% of them are through because of HPV. So this is orogenital sex giving rise to HPV-related cancers, both in the GI tract as well as in genitals. And people were not aware. When HPV vaccine came, people said, no, vaccine is only for female between 9 to 25 or 9 to 26, and thereafter they increased up to 45. And we argued that if you are approving a vaccine of HPV, which is only for female, and most of the female at that time, as per my knowledge, they were getting other STIs as well as HIV through male. So you are controlling in female, then you are vaccinating them, but those which are people who are vectors for them, who are bringing the infection, they are not controlled. They are not given vaccine. So thereafter, it has been approved also for male. But the vaccine cost is so much prohibitive. Three doses will cost around 10,000 rupees. Even if some concessions are provided, maybe about 8,000 or 9,000 rupees. How many people can take those injections at three doses? And that too, it is a preventive therapy. People don't even want to spend on curative therapy or treatment of some of the problems. How will they prevent spread on preventive therapy? So HPV vaccination is out of bound for almost 95% or more than 95% population. So if we are not vaccinating them against HPV, we are inviting that trouble. Number two, another vaccine which is available is hepatitis B. Hepatitis B vaccine has been made compulsory in all children from 2011. So all children born after 2011 in India, they are provided hepatitis B vaccine along with polio, tickle and other childhood immunization. But those people who are born before 2011, they are not vaccinated against hepatitis B. Hepatitis B is 100 times more transmissible than HIV. Hepatitis B vaccine is at a peanut cost. Entire three doses of vaccine at for the government cost or public cost, it will be not more than $2 or not more than $3. Still, people are not vaccinated. On their own, they are not vaccinating. On our side, from healthcare worker, we are not advocating. People are going and donating blood at blood banks. They are checked for hepatitis B, C, VDRL or syphilis and HIV. They are not even told that they are hepatitis B negative and there is something like hepatitis B vaccine available. At STI clinics or at ICTC, which is called Integrated Counseling and Testing Center of the governments, at several places, HIV checkup is done, but hepatitis B checkup is done, but they are not told that there is hepatitis B vaccine. So how will you vaccinate people? We even purposely looked into medical population, medical caregivers. Hardly 30 to 40% of the medical caregivers or doctors are vaccinated against hepatitis B. So these are the affairs of those vaccines, which are preventive vaccines for STIs, both very expensive vaccine and very cheap vaccine. So we are talking something, yes, it is important that we should concentrate on HIV treatment, ART, viral load, suppression, etc. But we are not even looking at those things which could explode in a very big way. It is already exploding. Hepatitis B rates in India are between 2 to 3%. In medical population, between 5 to 7%. And if they are vaccine-preventable infection, we are allowing them to harbor those infections, pass on those infections, and then finally end up with the cirrhosis. And there are the cirrhosis of liver patients among the VVIPs. For liver transplant, they go abroad and they get liver transplant done. But what about common people? They are not even accessing this kind of vaccine. So we need to look at those issues. Now also a lot of people demand if there is a AIDS vaccine. And we ask them, have you taken a hepatitis B vaccine? So the vaccine which is not available, people want to get it. Vaccine which is available, nobody is bothered.
Yes, a very important point, sir, that vaccines which are available, the uptake is not optimal, and the vaccines which are not available, there is, of course, like this, there should be a demand for that, and that should also be rolled out. I think it's a good point of to and a good reminder, Dr. Gilada, that since you mentioned hepatitis infection and HPV, for example, these are also the goals and to which our governments have committed, like, for example, reducing HPV related cancers by 1/3 by 2030. So again, 130 months or less than that is left to meet those goals also. And several cancer rates are on the rise, as we had heard in the previous dialogues too. Those of you who are watching us on Zoom, please leave a question in the chat box for Dr. Gilada, and we'll take it very soon in the open session. And if you want to speak, then also please raise your virtual hand or leave a message in the chat box. And on Facebook, you can also leave a comment there, and we will take as many as possible in this 1 hour we have with Dr. Gilada. So Dr. Gilada, you've already elucidated us on the challenges in the region and some successes as well. Do you want to share some best practice examples which this region has on HIV or SRSHR for other regions in the world, or some countries which are doing much better and which can be an inspiration to others, or there are some lessons for other countries?
Which vaccine you're saying?
So can you tell us about the best practice examples, like is something good happening in the region in terms of HIV response or response to SRSHR? Like I was reading one of your interviews, you're talking about the pharmaceutical capacity in the country. So any best practice examples, any good news which we have in terms of HIV and SRSHR, either in country or in the region?
No, I think one of the best responses from the country we are seeing in the region is Cambodia, where the HIV rates peaked around up to 2.3% about 15 years back, and about 10 years back they controlled very well. Similar thing with Thailand, where Thailand was ahead of India in percentage and in problem, but they created very good awareness and they controlled. Same thing in India also, we were expecting that it will go in an African way, and we were initially described as alarmist, and we used to think that it could be about we reach around 5 million or 10 million, but with all estimates it is around 2.5 or 2.3 million. As far as pharma companies are concerned, they have done their best. Most of the molecules which are very good molecules, they are already available in generic pharma form. Initially it was very difficult issue because even very well off people could not access the ART, and I remember in around 1996 when we started a triple drug regimen, 96, 97, 98, that period we used to get that around 22,000 rupees per month, which was around, at that time dollar was about 15 or 16, so it was more than $1,000 per month. And it has come down to so much today that same thing, which used to cost about $10,452 per patient per month, it is now $70, maybe $100. So that way, access to care, affordable ART, getting newest of the medicine, safest of the medicine, and best of the combination. Well, most of the combinations were initiated in India and they were copied up abroad. And we in India, almost all the commissions are there. So from government side, there was a good response. From pharma side, there has been good response. And even from people, what we see a difference between the scenario in Asia Pacific and the scenario in Africa. I had traveled extensively in Africa between 2000 to 2005. Maybe I made 50 trips. And when I used to go to those places, in their STI clinic or HIV clinic, despite one or two infections per family, people were not bothered. They were still taking risk. And in one of the STI clinic, I was sitting in Zambia, and one patient came and says, "Doc, I got syphilis," as if we got a syphilis award. So in India or in most of the Asia Pacific countries, people still have that kind of inhibition. Or they have a feeling that they have done something wrong. They will come and they do not see eye to eye to doctor. They look below and say, "I made a mistake." So the moment you say, "I made a mistake," there's a chance for improvisation. They improve. But when you say, "I want this and I want that, and how to prevent that infection," go and tell, both the sides are right. I'm not being judgmental. But basically, in our scenario, people have that kind of guilty feeling, guilty consciousness. They come out and they will say that I made a mistake. So there is a chance for improvisation. Probably that is the only reason. And that another reason is in Africa, it has been male circle and female circle, both were spreading infections. If male had, say, three or four partners or five partners, female had another five partners. In our circumstances, particularly when we talk about India, here 98% of the women are infected with HIV. They are infected by the husbands. And 2% of them who could have got on their own, maybe one is through sexual practices of their own, and 1% from the blood transfusion. So here has been males bringing infection to female in the family. Where if there are two different circles, the infection could have been not double, but at least four times more than what we have. So it could have been 2.3 into 4, that is 9 or 10 million infection. That didn't happen. So response from government, response from society, and response from pharma. Fantastic.
Yes, thank you so much, sir. And that is really important, and glad you mentioned Cambodia and Thailand. Cambodia is probably the first country in Asia Pacific to meet the 90-90-90 goals before the estimated deadline of 2020. So let's hope the other countries also increase their pace. Sir, as you know, 24th March is World Tuberculosis Day, and TB continues to be the big killer of people living with HIV, the biggest, as well as impact sexual and reproductive health also. For example, the genital tuberculosis is a major cause of infertility. All the rates vary, but a significant number, like 20% or something, was in one of the studies in Mumbai. It's our old data, about, I think, 20 years ago, old data, that over 1 lakh women with tuberculosis were deserted by their husbands. So there are a lot of other gender issues as well. So, sir, what is your message for World TB Day in context of HIV and sexual and reproductive health and rights?
Sorry, I could hear your part of contraception.
No, sir. What is your message on World TB Day? TB is the biggest killer of people living with HIV, as well as the genital tuberculosis rates are also very high. In some studies, it's more than 20% as the cause of infertility, for example. And over 100,000 women were deserted by their husbands because of TB. So stigma lurks too. And so what's your message here on World TB Day? It's on 24th March.
The message here will be, you see, basically to the men folks only, that we consider to women. We cannot say equality here because it will end up in men bringing infection to women and women also bringing on their own and give it to men. We need to have those kind of campaigns which we used to run here in a very big way in the early part of the HIV epidemic, where it was a campaign for monogamous relationship, campaign for preventive kind of relationship. And we used to use a lot of Indian connotation, Indian god, goddesses character, or film star character, those kind of issues, or some kind of popular movies and series, teleserials, which were talking about some particular issues. And we used to use that. And or wherever we knew, we realized that that is not possible, then we used to use preventive messages. So we had both previous messages and preventive messages. To give a small example, is to tell people, be good. If you cannot be good, be careful. In any case, be informed. So it gives all the messages that you be good. But I'm not a saint, or so I can ask people to take water from Ganges in hand and say, take a vote that I'll be purist of tomorrow. That may not happen. So we tell them, okay, if you cannot be good, be careful. So you take preventive steps, whatever you require. And in any case, be informed. So tomorrow, if you get any problem, whether it's STI, HIV, any HPV-related cancer, don't blame that I didn't know. You knew everything, so you be informed. You take any step, realistically understanding that what can be consequences. And there are people who are doing that. They take an informed decision to go with multiple partners, informed decision to take pre-prep or expose themselves, but at least they can't blame anyone that they didn't know. They got out of ignorance.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. That's important. And let's hope, because TB response is so connected to HIV response also, as well as the response to other like diabetes, nutrition, etc. They go hand in hand. And gender, sensitive response, that is also extremely important. Sir, coronavirus disease has impacted our lives in an unprecedented manner. Friends, Dr. Gilada was supposed to go to the international conference on retrovirus and opportunistic infections, and which could not happen. I mean, in person, but it happened virtually. And so there is a recommendation for people living with HIV from CROI, which was widely shared, that basically talks about ensuring ample medication supply, keeping vaccination up to date, establishing a plan for clinical care if the person is isolated or quarantined, and maintaining a social network, but remotely. And the slide is on your screens. So Dr. Gilada, as you have been following the coronavirus disease so well, so closely, and the challenge is really enormous in terms of health security, but also in terms of our economies in Asia Pacific and globally also. Sir, and the World Health Organization called for whole of government response, not just health department, but all other departments. Yesterday we heard, sir, that in Kerala, there are like, for example, free home delivery service, which is being provided to those quarantined. Sir, is coronavirus disease and pandemic impacting the sexual and reproductive health services and HIV? Can you please share some insights? And also a message for people living with HIV in the region. Thank you.
Yeah, I will compare corona with HIV. In the peak of the HIV also, HIV doubling time, in the number of doubling time, it was 1 year, then 2 years, then 5 years, then 10 years. So number of X number of cases of HIV would double after 1 year. In corona, they are doubling every 7 days, every 6 days. Number two, HIV was insidious virus, very slow. And may take years to explode. Here it is within few days, maybe 2 weeks. Thirdly, the reaction to HIV from the government or from people, it was very, very slow. It was so sluggish. I'm so fortunate, we are so fortunate to see a very fast reaction to corona all over the world. Maybe they had their own models or they wanted to follow X model versus Y model. Currently, India is following the model of Singapore and Thailand, or Singapore, Thailand, Hong Kong, aggressive model. So this kind of reaction for people. Fantastic. Now coming to your issue, how it has been impacted the healthcare. A lot of mobility is restricted. A lot of scare factors there. There are dichotomy in messages that we everywhere put huge advertisements on corona. Currently in Mumbai, no billboard can be there except corona. Means the Municipal Corporation of Mumbai has asked all the billboard advertisers to remove all the billboards and put only corona message. And in that message, they say, don't be scared of corona. Means basically, you are putting everywhere corona. People will be scared. And then you say that don't panic or don't get scared. So this is a dichotomy. Now, patients who are, because in our clinic we get almost 60% of our HIV positive patients come from outstation for treatment. Lot of appointments are getting rescheduled or cancelled. And they are, like some news comes, the WhatsApp industry is there in a big way, suddenly say there will be shortage of medicine because of two issues. One is, though 92% of the people with HIV in the world, they are taking medicines made from India. But these medicines are also made in India, but the ingredients of some of the medicines are coming from China because there is a competitive market. So it's called API, active pharmaceutical ingredient or intermediary. If there are 4, 5, 6 companies, if they are having production, then that production is going on. But that is good enough for a couple of months or so. And suddenly there will be demand. On one hand, there has been demand of lopinavir ritonavir, which is antiretroviral medicine used for second line, protease inhibitor type medicine, and that is showing some results in corona patient. So suddenly that stock is going for corona. Huge medicine stock have gone to Iran and other countries. So that is one side. But if pharmaceutical ingredients are not coming from China because of the shutdown in China, where the factories are not working, workers are not there. There will be shortage of inputs in our medicine. So our output will be reduced. And that will be, as soon as people read that there is a supply chain management issue, there will be transportation issue, there will be API issue. So people are trying to stock medicine for the next 6 months or so. Lots of call, like sometimes we have to also provide medicine to those people who cannot make it time. A lot of parcels go. Our parcels have gone 4 to 5 times more every day as compared to it was earlier. So there has been definite impact. Impact maybe out of little bit panic, but there is impact. And there are a lot of people who are coming from outstation, they have canceled their reservations, or they are scared of traveling in train or buses, because there are a lot of advisories to tell people that don't go in public, don't go in crowds. So without coming in, if they have to come in train or bus, they'll be always in crowd.
Right, sir. Thank you. Very important messages. And before we open it for the questions, sir, so what is your message for the 10th Asia Pacific Conference on Reproductive and Sexual Health and Rights, which will be hopefully held in Cambodia? But for now, we are it's being postponed because of COVID-19, and we are continuing with the online sessions fortnightly. What's your message,
Firstly, my deepest appreciation for this conference. For holding this conference. I happened to attend only one conference in Manila about 15 or 16 years back. Thereafter, somehow I couldn't go to these conferences because my focus has been only on HIV. So number one. Number two, they have taken a very timely decision to immediately reschedule and postpone the conference. So these two decisions are fantastic, and you'll be successful in holding the conference at a later date than what it could have been done now. Secondly, the agenda itself is very comprehensive, but please try to address the issues related to HIV and corona, though corona is not sexually transmitted. But by and large, people in medical profession or scientific profession, they are interested in what is new, what is happening. So even if corona is not sexual transmission, it is not related to maternal to child health, it is important as a viral disease. It is important as a new disease. So some session should be there on newer viral infections. There should be also focus on adult vaccination, which is one of the most neglected area in any country. So adult, because by the moment you say vaccine, this vaccine is for children. We do not think about adult vaccination. So session on adult vaccination, focus on newer infection, including corona, focus on HIV and fallouts of HIV in the increase of STIs. So you can take a journey from people like me. I'm an STI specialist. From STI, I went to doing HIV work. Thereafter, I focused only HIV and forgotten STIs. But now, with my work in HIV, with a lot of liberalization happened in the MSM and bisexuality, etc., in community, we started getting more and more STIs in both the population. So I need to look back at my career, and I'm currently spending half of my time in STI and half of my time in HIV. Earlier it was almost 95-5 or 90-10. So those kind of issues, how we can contain these issues, or how we can handle these issues comprehensively, that is important.
Right, sir. Thank you so much for this. And now we open it for the open session. So friends who are watching on Zoom, you are welcome to speak. So, and also, of course, you can leave your comment in the chat box. You will see a chat box on your screen. Please leave questions, comments, or request to speak in the chat box. Sir, in the chat box, Swapna Majumdar, she's a journalist from Delhi. She has left a question here. This, you will see our questions are on your screen also. So this is my question for Dr. Gilada. Recently, over 500 HIV positive people made an appeal to the Prime Minister for the inclusion in the Ayushman Bharat scheme. Considering this is a state-sponsored health assurance program, why does it leave out this community, and what can be done to include them?
Thank you.
This is Swapna Majumdar.
I know, actually, I don't know why they had to make this presentation, because Ayushman Bharat in campuses HIV also, they never said that HIV is not part of Ayushman Bharat. I happened to meet the chairman of Ayushman Bharat or CEO of Ayushman Bharat, fantastic person. So I don't think anybody would deny any kind of service to HIV positive people. The one of the best things which has happened even for HIV positive people is that Medicaid policies, which were having HIV in a negative way, like if you have HIV, you cannot get a Medicaid policy. Thereafter, they started denying claim to HIV positive people even for their non-HIV related issues. But recently, with the involvement of AIDS Society of India and NACO, National AIDS Control Organization, we prevailed upon the insurance companies of IDA. IDA is IRDA is one of the nodal agency for all insurance firms in India, and they prevailed upon all insurance companies, including Medicare, that you cannot discriminate. So there are there's a HIV AIDS Act 2017. Even that act can be used to get HIV related issues to either Ayushman Bharat or IDA or anywhere. No one can deny any services to HIV positive people. No one can discriminate them because they are HIV positive. So I don't think why there was a need or some people felt that HIV will not be included in Ayushman.
Yes, thank you, sir. Thanks. I think that is really helpful, especially since you met the Ayushman Bharat head also. So there is another question from Malaysia, and Keneko says that HPV vaccine is available for girls. So should it be available for all? I think you did make that point, right? Probably she means that for boys as well. HPV vaccine.
Yeah, it should be for all, for men and women, because HPV is a sexually transmitted infection. And in sexual activity, men and women are equal. Men are more than men, women actively involved in sexual activity. And actually, it should be given to both men and women, particularly when they are young children. Before 15 years of age, only 2 doses are required. After 15 years of age, 3 doses are required. So when the vaccine is very expensive, it's better to vaccinate them much before 15 years of age. So they develop immunity. They don't catch HPV at all.
Sir Zafar from Bangladesh has said about CSE, sir, about the comprehensive sexuality education. So this is being rolled out in different countries in Asia Pacific. So the question is that some people in Bangladesh feel that, and maybe this is perception is shared in other countries also, that comprehensive sexuality education will increase sexual activity. So is it, so can you please give a feedback or your insights on that?
What is the question from Bangladesh?
Some people feel that comprehensive sexuality education will increase sexual activity. So comprehensive sexuality education will increase sexual activity. So will it increase sexual activity or will it increase safe sex, more education, more information, age appropriate and stuff? That is the question. How to respond to that?
There has to be a comprehensive policy. There has to be guidance to people which is safe, which is safer, and which is unsafe. So everything unsafe is not, which is everything not unsafe is not always safe. It can be safer also. Right. So that policy has to come, and people should be, particularly children should be educated before they start experimenting with their sexuality. I forgot to also mention about HPV. We are trying to prevail upon Indian pharma companies or Indian researchers that the way we copied patents and made ARV available, accessible, and much cheaper to all over the world, can we do that even for HPV vaccine? And once that is done, then it will become accessible to the entire region or all the countries in the world who could not have afforded HPV vaccine.
Right, sir. Thank you. Sir, on the Facebook page, there is a comment from Varuni, and she says PrEP is available in Thailand. Is it available in other countries also in the region?
PrEP.
Yes, sir.
It is very simple thing to understand. The medicine for PrEP and PEP are the same. Currently, what is used for the basic PEP, post exposure prophylaxis, is tenofovir and tenofovir. And for PrEP, it is also the same medicine. No doctor can be stopped from prescribing PEP or PrEP once it is licensed. Once you have tenofovir and tenofovir available in the market, it is licensed for treatment of HIV, it is licensed for PEP, the same thing can be used for PrEP. Secondly, the person who is taking for PrEP, or if he has not taken properly, or if he is continuing the activity, for that person, this acts as also PEP. Because PrEP is, there are two types of PrEP. One is a daily PrEP, they are taking daily medicine, and one is episodic PrEP, that is, or event-based PrEP, where you want to have one particular event which is going to be unsafe, then you take four tablets. One tablet about 12 hours before, two tablets at the time of event, and one tablet 12 hours after. So within 24 hours, you take four tablets. But if the person is going to have multiple activity per week, then there is no point in giving four tablets per six. That person takes one tablet every day. Now, if that person is taking PrEP and having sometimes sex, sometimes not having sex, sometimes exposing, not exposing, for that person, and if he is continuing for that particular event, it is like PEP also. Only for additional drug which we have been giving PEP, which is called high-risk PEP, where you have to have from basic, you need to add one more drug. That time, it is different than PrEP. Otherwise, PrEP and PEP, there is no difference in medicine.
Right. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. And also, thanks for mentioning PEP, the post-exposure prophylaxis, and of course, all the info. Sir, I see some more questions. One is from the TB program, Noi. She's from Thai TB program. She's asking about the interaction of dolutegravir with TB drugs. And the other one is about differentiated care. So is differentiated care being used here? I don't know much about it.
I couldn't understand.
Yes, sir. So one question is about from the TB program in Thailand about the interaction, drug interaction between dolutegravir and TB drugs. So do they have to be careful about that? And yeah, let's take that one.
You see, drug interaction will be there always. And there are select platforms where there's one website from Liverpool where you can put in X drug on A side and Y drug on the other side, it will show whether there's drug interaction is there or not. Now, common drug interaction in dolutegravir is TB medicine, which is rifampicin. And whenever you are using dolutegravir TB patient who is on rifampicin, we have to use dolutegravir double dose. Rather than 50 milligram OD, we give 50 milligram BD two times. It also has an interaction with a diabetes drug, which is metformin. So in this case, metformin cannot be given more than 1 gram twice a day. So not more than 2 gram metformin. It also has an interaction with anemia medicines like ferric acid or ferrous medicine, where we need to give at different time than the dolutegravir. So every drug will have interaction. We need to look at that. But if you look at comparison of many other drugs and dolutegravir, it has least drug interaction, least. And next one is in the line is bictegravir, which is a newer integrase inhibitor. So these two drugs are least drug interaction. Other drugs we are having lot of drug interaction.
Right, thank you, sir. And friends, there are only a few minutes left. So those who are on Zoom, and if you would like to speak, so please raise your virtual hand. I see people from Indonesia, Ingrid, and Dr. Tin Muang Hitwe is there. So Dr. Tin Muang Hitwe is right now online on Zoom. So will you like to speak, Dr. Tin Muang? Your question, which you had asked yesterday, probably Dr. Gilada may have some answers for that. You need to unmute yourself, Dr. All right, anyway, sir, he was asking about, there is no case in Myanmar of COVID-19 and Laos. So he was asking the panelists yesterday about how can other countries like India help in training the sample collectors. So that was one of his questions, that why is there no case yet in Myanmar and Laos? And the second question was about training capacity of if countries can
what
help
each other. Samples, first question was sample collection.
Sir, so first question was why there is no case of COVID-19 despite so much of exposure in terms of international travel, etc., in Myanmar and Laos. So it could be due to health capacity, and the other one was how can other countries help each other in terms of building capacity for sample collection.
You are talking about an HIV patient or to whom?
Sir, the question was about COVID, the coronavirus disease. Yeah.
Population. Population is not there.
Right. All right.
In which population is not there, despite exposure?
Sorry, sir. I couldn't get it, sir.
Can you repeat that? Not there in which population?
Yes, sir. So COVID, sorry for the internet. I think COVID, there is no case of coronavirus disease in Myanmar and Laos, two nations in Asia Pacific, Myanmar and Laos. So do we need more surveillance? Do we need more testing? Or do we need more health capacity, health system strengthening in those nations? That's what he had asked. He's the editor of Health Digest Journal.
Bobby.
He has also sent a question on, sir. Sorry to interrupt you, sir. He has also sent a question on the chat box. If any additional training need is there for Myanmar sample collectors.
See, Bobby, if they do not find a single case in Myanmar or Laos, it doesn't mean that there are not one single case. Number two,
right.
It depends on how many samples are collected and how many of them are positive. Number three,
absolutely.
If they have been always collecting sample for any other issues, we sample to collect the issue, a sample. So we cannot say currently that A, the sample collectors are wrong, or B, Myanmar is free of COVID. We cannot say that. It will take time to say that.
Right, sir. Sir, your final message before we conclude today?
My final message is, I send you a brevity. Despite everywhere people are talking only COVID in the world, probably this is the only seminar or webinar happening on something else than COVID in the medical profession, anywhere in the world. So I really salute your determination of you and your conference, which is going to be held in Cambodia. Very good initiative. People are sitting idle. That a lot of things are not moving, so activity should go on. There are no conferences, there are no seminar, there is no CME, there are not going to be any meetings, there are not going to be any social gathering. What do people do? So keep on doing such kind of webinars, and I'll be happy to participate. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Gilada. That's a very positive note to end, despite the gloom of COVID-19. Thank you so much, friends, all those who are listening, joined us on Zoom, and those who are watching on Facebook Live of the APCR SHR10. As you know, APCR SHR10 Dialogues, these are fortnightly interviews on sexual and reproductive health and rights in context of Asia Pacific and 2020 realities and SDG goals every fortnight. And with the challenge which has been posed by the coronavirus disease, these online and virtual platforms for information exchange, knowledge sharing, as Dr. Gilada said about learning, these should be fully utilized. And this is one of the examples of our commitment to encourage online and virtual means. So see you all in another fortnight, next fortnight, on another issue of related to SRSHR in Asia and Pacific. Thank you so much, Dr. Gilada. Thank you again. And all power to you for all the good work that you do. Thank you so much.
Thank you,
thank you, friends.